Hello, my name's Randy Price and I work for the LSU Ag Center. I work here at the Dean Lee Research and Extension Center, and one of my duties is looking at the new technologies that are available here in Louisiana that farmers might be interested in. We have a few of those technologies here. Most of those deal with precision farming because that's one of the bigger areas that uses technology right now. I'll talk about some of the different things, the drones that are available, and then show you some handheld stuff that you can use to help evaluate your crop. First, I want to talk about there are high-end systems. This is a high-end drone here that we've kind of put together with a multispectral camera. This camera has different imagers built in. We don't recommend that beginners start with this. You can if you want, but there's a lot of processing that's involved, a lot of software, and a lot of high-end computing that's needed to actually make this work. Now, you can buy a package for this type of drone. Usually they're in the $8,000 to $10,000 range. And if you are a new or novice to this, that will help out because the package may allow you to do everything from start to finish with one set of software that they've created. And we do recommend if you go with this type of camera that you do that. We do find though that a lot of people get these and they haven't used them as much as they thought they had or would because of the technology and the cost involved. I do want to talk about this little drone. If you're new to drones and things and you want to get out and just look at your farm field, this is a nice little drone that just came out about 6 months ago that will allow you for a very low price, $400, to have something in your truck that you could pull out, fly over a field, get a look at it real quick, and even do a little bit of mapping if you wanted. Doesn't map as good as these higher end drones, but it does do a pretty good job, and we'll talk about a technique that you can use to do some mapping with this that doesn't cost any money that you can do for free. To show you a little bit about this drone, be sure you buy a nice case with it. One thing I also recommend, you see we got cables hanging out of ours. We actually put the charging cables in the case so that when I get home, I can plug it in and it'll charge when it's in the case. Be careful, sometimes it can get a little bit hot doing that depending on the drone you have. The reason we do that is most of the accidents that occur with drones that we've seen are because of battery failures. People don't charge the battery up, try to fly it too long, things like that. So we do recommend always the night before charge this stuff up. If you charge it up every night before you use it, have plenty of fresh batteries, you probably will never have a problem with the drone. So that's one thing to keep in mind. I do want to talk a little bit about this drone because this is a good one for an individual farmer who's never done drone work before, who just wants to see what he could do with it. Maybe you're just interested in flying in the back of a field, trying to see how far the irrigation's gone. Maybe just wanting to see how the sugar cane's burning off, things like that. We've done things like that before. This drone is very low cost, $400, just came out 6 months ago. This drone was done by DJI because a lot of countries have a 250-gram minimum weight, and if you get below that minimum weight, you don't have to have a license to use this for commercial purposes. So that's what this drone was built for. It was built to have commercial quality type functions while still having a very light weight. So do know though that the U.S. got rid of the minimum weight. They still want you to have a Part 107. If you do fly this for commercial use day-to-day basis, you do need to get the Part 107 license even to use this drone. But if you're just doing it for educational reasons, you just want to go out and see a field, you're just curious what a drone can do, you can get a drone like this, not have to get the Part 107, just fly it for research and educational type purposes. If you do start using it on a day-to-day basis where you see I'm using it to actually enhance my farm utilities and actually use it to help me make more money, then you do need to get the Part 107 license. So that's what we tell people. A couple nice things about this drone and a couple things that you want to be, that you should know about it. This drone, although as small as it is, it flies for a very long time, 20 to 30 minutes, as long as the other ones. You'd be surprised how long it flies. It is very small. Some of our bigger ones can take a little bit more wind, but we have had this in quite windy conditions, and it has a little bit of a hard time fighting it because it is smaller, but it does do pretty well. So you may be limited on the wind speeds when you do fly this. If you do get in a situation where you're flying at high and all of a sudden there's a wind warning, you can feel the drone not wanting to make headway to get back to you, just come down in altitude, get lower to the ground where the winds are less, and then bring it back. I do like one thing about this drone. We used to have airplanes that were foam. One thing we said about those versus this bigger drone was if this fell out of the sky, I really wouldn't want that to hit the window of my truck because I'm pretty sure it would break it. The foam airplanes, we kind of like those, and we talked about one safety aspect was they were foam. If they hit something, it's going to do very little damage. This little device here, all plastic, hardly any metal, under 250 grams. This is something that could probably fall out of the sky. You wouldn't hurt much with it. So I do like the safety feature of that with this drone. So if you want to do mapping with this drone, I said I'd tell you a little bit about how to do mapping for free with it. Most of the time for the other drones, you have to buy software. It's anywhere from $2,000 to $4,000 for the copy. It's quite expensive. The reason you buy software is the FAA has a rule that you can't fly this out of line of sight in over 400 feet. Because of the 400 feet aspect, you usually got to tilt the camera and look straight down because you got to look straight down on the crop because of the soil versus the crop plant rows and things like that. You only get about 5 or 6 acres per image. Because of that, to do a 300 acre field, you're going to have to take a lot of images. And the specialized software that costs a couple $1,000s will put those images back together to give you one large mosaic of the farm field. And that's where the cost and the problems come in, is when you start trying to do that. We've been doing some experimentation with this drone where you can fly video looking straight down, hand guided, you know, go down the field, make a turn, you're seeing it on your tablet or your phone, come back doing video back and forth, a couple hundred feet up in the air. You take that video out and there's a free program called Microsoft ICE, Image Composite Editor. You can download it from the Microsoft website. You can Google it, whatever you want, Bing it, whatever. And you can get that program for free. You can put that video in that program and it will make a map, a 2D map from that video or the stills that you might shoot with this this drone. Not as good as a $2,000 software. Sometimes there's waviness and things depending on how straight you could fly it and how much overlap. Make sure you have a little bit of overlap on your return passes. But it does do quite a good job for a program that's completely free. Now bear with it also, you're analyzing video here, which is a pretty extensive process, so you might need a pretty hefty computer for that. We do recommend gaming computers. Those are usually higher end type computers. We have computers that we build ourselves that are even higher end than that. If you have a question about what computer to use and the processing resources that are most needed in this process, give us a call because we can help you out with that. Sometimes we don't recommend servers. Computers do work good, but we found out problems with the servers are, they're not really meant to be turned off and on, where a gaming computer, you can turn it off and on a little bit better. And they both seem to have similar performances when you do this mosaicing process. So that'll help you out on some of the drone stuff. I do want to talk about this. If you get a drone, usually you need some type of tablet or phone device. Your phone will work fine, but there are some better types of phones for this type of purpose. And I'll tell you why. This is one here. This is a tablet for Apple. We do find that the Apple stuff, we do kind of recommend it a little bit more than the Android stuff, because usually there's a cable between this and your transmitter to allow you to see the video, which is real important when you're flying a field, seeing what's going on, making sure you got overlap, things like that. The Apple stuff is a little bit better dealing with the serial transmission. And what I mean when I say that is, say I got a drone, I'm going to fly up in the air, and I'm going to lock in the aperture so it's not changing as I fly over the field. Well, I may use the DJI app that goes with the drone to do that. So I need to use that app to get up in the air. Then when I land it, I may flip over to the software that actually does automated flights for me, like Pix4D Capture or Drone Deploy or a couple of different programs like that. The problem you'll find with Android is it has a hard time switching the serial port between the programs and it will give you fits. So the Apple, for some reason, their operating system's just a little bit better at that. It can flip between the programs instantaneously. It'll save you a lot of time out in the field. Now, if you just use one program all the time, you could probably plug it into your Android phone and you'll never have a problem. But if you start doing this flipping between programs, the Apple's better. We do usually recommend a tablet. It's a little bit bigger, especially if you're doing this a lot. If you notice here, we have a little base here. Here in Louisiana, it gets quite hot in the summertime. Apple tablets and all tablets are bad about overheating. You get outside, you try to use them, and they're in direct sunlight, they overheat and go off. It's kind of unnerving when it goes off when you're flying it. Usually the drone will come back because it has returned to home functions. But the problem can be that you can't see anymore, and it's just a little bit unnerving. So we recommend, actually, most of these drones have very good transmitters. We've had very good luck using them inside your vehicle. Now, when I say that, we leave the door open. So we can stick the transmitter outside with our hand if we need to. If we start to lose transmission, we look at the drone. Remember, line of sight is one of the things you have to maintain when flying a drone in the U.S. You can usually see it through the window if you park your truck just right or looking out the side window. But this will allow you to keep the tablet in the truck where you can see it better and still fly the drone outside where you have air conditioning. Plus, you'll like it better because there's a little bit of air conditioning for you. Now, if you do that, we do recommend this. And you're saying, well, Randy, that's just a regular USB cable between the transmitter and the tablet. Well, if you notice, this is a quite long one, 5 feet or more. This allows us that if we do have a problem, I can step outside with the transmitter and still control the drone if I see there's a problem. So do get a longer cord for that. We have one other thing to show you here. If you mount a tablet in your truck, it can be kind of hard to do. You know, some people have no problem drilling a hole in their dash, putting a mount. You can see we have ball mounts here. We've actually found that you can take a ream of paper, 18 or 8 by 14 and a half, the longer sheets, legal sheets. Just take a ream of paper, duct tape it up, mount your ball on that, glue you some type of tool guard or some type of rubber on the bottom. This can set on your dash, and you got a nice mount for your iPad or whatever you got it hooked to. This can ride in a bumpy condition pretty well, and it'll stay on your dash, and you don't got to drill a hole in your dash. I will say one other thing about the Apple tablets. We found that a lot of software, if you do end up with an Android or Apple type product, make sure you get the Apple one that has a cell phone utilities. The Apples with cell phone utilities, the phones or the tablets, have the GPS built in to the tablet, okay? And you say, well, why would that be a problem? I'm not really gonna get on the internet, or maybe I have a mobile hotspot through my phone, which is what we do, because we don't want to put a card in every tablet that we have in each vehicle. Well, what that does is if I pull this tablet out and I have software and I wanna walk back to a position in the field, there's a GPS built in here, I can see that really well. The other tablets, without the cell phone capability, they try to triangulate between Wi-Fi and other things. You'll find yourself half to several miles off from the mark, and it won't allow you to do that. So always buy the tablet for this purpose, even though you're not going to use the cell phone part of it, or never put a SIM card in it, because it has that GPS built in. Now let's talk about one other thing. So let's say you're not worried about getting drones, but you do kind of want to quantify something in the field. We got one other tool here. These have gotten kind of hard to find. This is called a Trimble handheld green seeker or crop sensor. These sensors are quite nice. They have a little LEDs in the bottom, so they're an active light source. So they'll work at night, they'll work in clouds, daytimes, things like that. It's pulsed. They put out a red and an infrared signal, and then they have a sensor that receives it. This will give you a good crop reading about the health of your crop. Usually when you see a reading like this, 0.2 and below is like soil or dead things. 0.2 to 0.6 is like things that are growing, you know, intermediately well. 0.6, 0.7 are doing better. 0.8 is things that are growing great. They get all thumbs up. So this is a good device if you can't see a difference in your crop, or you put some some test plots out, you try some different nutrient or nitrogen or different things, and it's the same type of crop. This is a good device to allow you to see actual numbers of what's growing better. Keep in mind, the higher the number, the closer to one, the better the crop grows. So when you use this device, you don't want to hold it too close. It'll tell you EC for too close or too far away. It'll tell you too far away. You want to hold it about 18 to 24 inches off the crop. You just push the trigger and you walk with it. Go, you know, 30, 20, 50 feet, something like that, however long your plot is. When you let go of the trigger, it will actually give you an end reading that's an average of the whole length you walked. So when you get to the end of whatever you're trying to measure, you can let that up and you can get a reading. And as you see here, it's doing quite good because it has a reading of 0.85, which is real good. So if you see that go down to 0.7, 0.6, things like 0.6, things like that, not as good. Now do keep in mind, for you guys just getting some readings, this sees a certain width. So if you have small plants, you're going to see some of the soil background that factors in, lowers the reading, things like that. Excuse me. So if you try to compare this to drone readings, we actually go over the crop and get a reading, and then we go between the crop and get a reading, and we average those readings. Now you'd say, Randy, why do you do that? Well, when I fly a drone and I put a box over a plot, four row plot or something, I'm actually seeing the plants and the soil in between. And to get this reading to match, I have to get the in-between readings and the over-the-crop readings. Now, for you guys having your own work, you may not have to do that. You may not care about the in-between readings. You may have different nitrogen rates, and you'll just go over the top of the crop. But if you start comparing this to drone readings, and it's large blocked areas, you really got to do that averaging to get the correct reading, because that's what the drone sees. Well, I'd like to also conclude by letting you know that if you have any questions about some of these technologies or some uses for your farm fields, you can contact me, Randy Price, at the LSU Ag Center. My email and stuff are listed on the website. I'd also like to say that there are several other agents and people around the state who also do precision farming with me. Dennis Burns, R.L. Frazier up north. Down south is Jimmy Flanagan. We also have a couple researchers that you can contact at LSU, Luciano, Brenda Tabana, and those people can help you out. So if you have a question, give us a call. I'd also like to thank for the support. We do get a little bit of support each year to help us buy the newer drones and to do some of this work from the Soybean and Wheat Commission, and also from the Rice Board and from the American Sugar Cane League.